Okay, all right. Now we're rolling again. So now we'll get into some unedited space, which is more free flowing conversation. So pretty much you can say whatever you like. You can ask me questions too. My expertise is understanding, you know, exploring why we do what we do, you know, what we are as a species, and you know, why are we dealing with the situation. I devote my life to understanding that, because I feel like it's us doing it. So obviously we need to understand it. So you can ask me questions too, if you feel it's appropriate. And I'll obviously...
Yeah, I mean, actually, I don't know much about like your story. So I'd love to hear, before we get started, just like what is your background and what do you do and all of that? And I might pour myself a drink while we, so I have something to sip on while we chat.
All right. Sounds good. Look, ultimately, yeah, a bit of a long, convoluted journey to get to where I'm at now. I think the essence, what I do with my life today, is probably just getting closer and closer to, you know, who I always was as a person, in terms of, you know, my nature and my skills and abilities and all that kind of thing. But yeah, I started life off getting a marketing degree, working in business and advertising agencies around the world, and always just found the integrity issue became too big for me, and too much compromise, and advertising was too much about bending reality to say the right thing rather than the truth. And
right.
a lot of the products, just I started learning too much about things and saw a lack of integrity in so many of the industries that I was having to represent. So I dropped out of that, and then studied psychology at uni for a little bit, and I thought that that was very limited in terms of what they were saying, so I lost interest in psychology, and then I ended up going into radio announcing, like talkback radio, thinking it might be good to be able to just start communicating with the world. For whatever reason, that became interesting to me. And in the process of that, I interviewed a psychologist who, this was about 17 years ago now.
Okay.
Loved the conversation so much. He said, "Would you consider coming to Melbourne and working in my psychology practice?" And I said, "Well, I've never done it before." And, you know, I hadn't studied psychology as such. And then, you know, other than at uni where I dropped out because I didn't want to see it through. And yeah, then I ended up taking this job and got myself a diploma in counseling just to officially get into the system, and ended up working in this psychology center, which has kind of changed my life. And then I realized the limitations that were in that in terms of understanding human behavior. It wasn't explaining everything that I was seeing. It was more about right. getting people back into the system, but the system was corrupt and the system's not well. The system's destroying the planet, and the system is a representation of the human mind. So for me, it became obvious to move on from psychology and just work it out for myself. And that led to me writing a book called The Insanity of Humanity, which is...
I love the title.
Yeah, just pretty much saying we're all a bit cuckoo and we need to get real about yeah. that and be honest about what we are as a species. And
we are a terrible species.
yeah. And you know, so for me, it's just been a long journey, and that, you know, led into because I've always loved animals, but you know, obviously uneducated in that department. And once I educated myself, it became very easy to become a vegan and to not partake in any cruelty or abuse, which I, you know, was always naturally that way, but you know, that became very huge to me, just to discover the level of abuse and the nature of it and just how prolific it is in the world.
And how long ago was that?
That was about 8 years now, I guess. I was vegetarian for quite a while before that, because when I was working as a talkback radio announcer, I had a caller phone up and they got really angry with me and said, "You seem like a lovely guy, but you partake in the consumption of animals." And she abused me quite, you know, severely publicly. And it was like a gift. So it was a real, like, someone, you know, I needed someone, because I'd never really spoken to, never met anyone, I guess, that even was vegetarian, let alone vegan. And it was a nice sort of conscious slap for me. And from that moment forth, that was the wake-up call I needed. And that was a long time ago now, back early 90s, I guess. And yeah, it's just been a long progression of just journeying. And then obviously now what's important is to see that it's not stopping. The onslaught of destruction is, you know, even though there's a growth in the vegan movement, the growth of destruction is far grander, and it's like a tsunami of ignorance, you know, falling upon the planet. And so me personally, I'm just contributing whatever I can to help wake people up and to see whether we can even wake up, you know, or is there a divide? Is there good people and not so good people? And some people are going to defend cruelty to their last breath. I don't know. I guess I'd like to find out what our species is capable of, ultimately.
So one of the cool things that I don't know if you've heard of this study or not, but there was a study done in 2011 by a group of scientists that wanted to figure out if there's a tipping point for ideas. Like, is there a point of no return where an idea is just, it's going to take over? And what they found is actually if just 10% of the population has an unwavering belief in an idea, that it's actually inevitable for the rest of the majority of the society to adopt that idea. And one of the scientists that worked on that study said he would kind of, you know, he would see the idea struggling very, very slowly to get up to that 10%. It was almost so slow you almost could not see it happening.
Yep.
But at the second that it hit the 10% mark of the population, it spread like a flame. And so I always try and keep that in mind when I'm talking about all these solutions. Like, there's three solutions that I have the most hope for. One is solar power. Like, the price of solar power has dropped by 80% in the last 5 years. Here in the U.S., every 2.5 minutes, a solar array is going up on a home or a business. So it keeps getting cheaper and cheaper, and it's getting more and more competitive with, like, the old school forms of fossil fuel consumption, like coal and natural gas. And then the other solution is electric cars, which I think is also taking off and is going to get closer and closer to that 10% tipping point. And then, you know, the number one solution that I always tell people about is cutting back on your meat and dairy, because it doesn't take, you know, that big sort of step financial commitment that putting solar panels on your roof or buying an electric car.
Yep.
You know, people don't buy cars every year. They buy cars, you know, sometimes every decade. So not everybody's, like, in the market to buy a car right now. Hopefully they'll make their next car electric. And then, you know, some people live in apartment buildings, or they live in homes that have a lot of trees around them and a lot of shade, or it's not a good, you know, facing the right direction for the sunlight. So there's all kinds of reasons that can sort of stop you from those other two solutions.
Yep.
But veganism, I mean, like, all of us 3 times a day, right, sit down to eat a meal and can make the choice to leave meat and dairy off of our plates. And it doesn't cost you any extra money. And it's like, you know, not only is it good for the animals, but it's good for the planet and it's good for your own health. And I, like you, started out as vegetarian. I was vegetarian for many, many years. And then I started to learn more about, you know, just how horrific the dairy industry is and how destructive it is. Not only, you know, is it absolutely horrible for the animals, we kill in the United States, I think, 10 billion animals a year for food. But it's obviously, like, horribly destructive to our environment. More greenhouse gas emissions go into raising animals for food and the entire transportation sector combined. So I think everybody likes to sort of, they like to equate their carbon footprint with the kind of car they drive and how much fuel they burn. And, you know, certainly I have an electric car, I drive a Tesla, I've got solar panels on my roof, you know, but I understand I'm in a really unique situation, and that's a real privilege to be able to be an early adopter of an electric car, of solar panels. But, you know, veganism, when I first made that switch, which it's been 5 years, a little over 5 years now since I made the switch, I just immediately, you know, that was like the moment where every single choice that I made every day was in line with my ethics, and that I no longer wanted to participate in anything that was in some way harming an animal. And I think before, I just sort of, you know, I grew up eating a lot of cheese and dairy products, and while I was vegetarian almost my whole life, it was like something that I was used to, right? Like, I remember being a kid and eating macaroni and cheese, and now, you know, I still have macaroni and cheese in my closet now, or my pantry now, but it's just it's a vegan macaroni and cheese, you know, and I have vegan ice cream, and I have vegan pizza, and I have vegan cheeses in my fridge, and I can eat all the things that I ate before I went vegan. I'm just eating vegan versions of it, and I think it's just becoming easier and easier to be vegan. My husband's actually from New Zealand, so he grew up eating a lot of meat and lamb and the meat pies, and, you know, he's vegan now, and I think, you know, as the world sort of wakes up and our eyes open to what we're participating in, especially with 7.4 billion people on the planet, I think more and more people are going to make the switch, not only because they're the exposure of the cruelty that's happening within the factory farming industry, but also, you know, there's a lot of people that go vegan for their health. Mm. That's becoming quite popular. I know that I always used to try and convince people based on animal rights and the planet and the environmental issues, because that's what I care about. And I'm not really doing it for my health. Obviously, I wouldn't be eating vegan macaroni and cheese. but then I realized, like, some of them were actually being converted by seeing movies like Forks Over Knives that were strictly based on the health stuff. So now I've realized I need to talk about all the reasons to be vegan and not just the reasons that I care about, because you never know what it is that's gonna resonate with someone. But I think, you know, as this information gets out to the world, it's healthier for you. There's all these amazing vegan athletes in the world. In every single sport that you can imagine, there's going to be a vegan that's exceeding in it, whether it be like Ironman or running or boxing or like UFC fighting or running. Like, all of the sports have vegans that are doing well. So it's like, that's getting out there. The animal cruelty is getting out there with movies like Cowspiracy and Racing Extinction that highlight the environmental impacts of meat. There's just more and more information, I think, getting to the public. And then at the same time, you have all these new vegan companies that are sort of taking off, like, you know, Beyond Meat and Gardein and this new Impossible Foods, where like people can get the kinds of food that they're used to eating as meat and dairy eaters, but they're just buying vegan versions of it. So they're not having to give up like flavor or like that comfort food that they grew up with as a child. Like I said, for me was sort of like the macaroni and cheese. You can still have those things. And so it just sort of feels like if there's no sacrifice and you can eat all the same kinds of flavors that you had before, without harming any creatures, without harming the planet, and it's like healthier for your body, why in the world would you not make the switch? And I think more and more people are going to come to that conclusion, and we're going to get closer and closer to that 10% tipping point where eventually it'll be like, I'm hoping that one day it's going to be strange to see an internal combustion engine car on the street. They'll all be electric, and it'll be almost weird when somebody drives by in a gas-powered internal combustion car. And I hope the same thing happens, you know, with veganism. I think it might take a little bit longer, but, you know, where people are almost like, it's almost weird when somebody is still eating dead animals.
So given that the whole fabric of society, like business, like if you go out shopping, it's extraordinary to find out how many products use animal byproducts, or, you know, whether it's directly meat or whether it, you know, something to do with the animal, the death and the murder industry and what they do, like whether it be, you know, tires, you know, have animal products in it. A lot of people wouldn't know that. It's sort of like in so many different sources. We've invested a lot, you know, psychologically, financially, in so many ways in this lifestyle we've created. Do you feel that this movement is just founded? What's it founded with, do you think, that's going to pull us out of that? Is it just the purity of it, the truth of it? Like why would we give up something that we've been addicted to and functioning in such a manner for so long? And I know you're saying that, you know, is it just one of those things you think that's just going to take off? And if it is, why really? Like, why would we suddenly change? Why would we become caring? Or is it that we just were ignorant and not thinking, and suddenly we need to think more, and that's going to change the whole fabric of things? Or...
Well, that's an interesting question. And actually, you having studied psychology, you probably know this one. I remember reading a study that was about like how to get people to, it was a hotel chain that did an experiment to see, how do we get people to not want to wash their linens? Like, if they're staying at the hotel for multiple nights, you know, it saves a lot of water. It's good for the planet for them to say, okay, don't wash my linens, don't take my towels, I'll reuse them. So the hotel did it. I can't remember what chain it was, but they did like an experiment where they left three different messages in rooms. So the first message was something like, you know, if you don't have us wash your linens during your stay, we will give you $10 off your next night. So it was all based on money and saving money. The second one was based on the planet, and it said, you know, if you don't wash your linens and your towels while you're here and you reuse them, you're going to save X number of gallons for the planet. Yeah. And then the third sign that they left in the rooms, which was by far the most effective and people reacted to the most, was a sign that said 75% of the people that stayed in this room before you did not have us wash their linens and just had us do it. We used the same linens and towels over throughout their stay. And that was by far actually the most effective sign. Mm. And I think what that shows is that, you know, that's like peer pressure. It shows that you can implement peer pressure from other people around you, even if they're not standing there in the room with you. Mm. They don't have to be standing there in the room with you. You just have to know that the majority of the people made that decision. And so, like, it's more normal for you to not wash your linens than it is for you to be selfish and have them wash your linens every single night. So I feel like, you know, hopefully we'll get to a tipping point where, you know, it's sort of sad to think that, like, that's why people are going to change, because they're going to feel judged by their peers. Mm. But I mean, that study kind of shows that is something that's really effective, and that if the people around you, if their eyes are opening and they're going to judge you, and in some way you are going to feel guilty because you're the one person left at the table that's still ordering meat products or animal products, that you will give into that, like, wanting to fit in and wanting the others to accept you. Like, you know, is that some sort of old tribal thing that we've had from, you know, millions of years ago, that we, you know, feel safer in numbers and we want to fit in and it's good for us to get along with the other people that are in our tribe? And so it's like a self-survival thing. It's an evolution thing. I don't know. But that study, I remember, like, sort of realizing, oh, that's so interesting, because if I was trying to get somebody to not wash their linens as an environmentalist, I would have definitely pitched the you're going to save X number of gallons of water. Mm. And that one proved to not be effective at all. And then many people will say, oh, well, people will go green when it makes, you know, financial sense to do that. Like, if you can get a big corporation to change out all their light bulbs from incandescents to LEDs because they're saving money, well, they're going green, but they're not going green because they want to, like, do the right thing. They're just going green because at the end of the day, it's going to save them money. So maybe with corporations, it's going to work like that. But I think with people, it will be sort of that, you know, the majority of people's eyes are starting to open and the awareness is starting to spread. Mm. And then I already see a divide. Like, there already are people that are, well, I'm vegan for health reasons. And so when other vegans are like, oh, well, I'm an ethical vegan, you know, and there's this little, like, sort of thing, well, I'm doing it for ethics and you're doing it, like, for your health. And we shouldn't, there is, like, a little divide, right? Even within the vegan movement that I've seen happen, where it's like people are very vocal about, like, the reason that they are vegan, and it almost feels like the ethical vegans are judging the vegans that are doing it for their health. And I don't like that. I mean, I don't care why you go vegan, like, just as long as you go vegan, because at the end of the day, if you're going vegan for your own health, you're still saving a ton of animal lives.
Yeah.
And you're still doing something good for the planet, even if you're doing it, like, for your own health. So I feel like we should be really accepting of people that come to this place, regardless of the reason why they come to this place. I don't like to see, like, infighting within the vegan movement about that stuff. But I don't know. I don't know what it will be that eventually makes us care. But that study kind of says to me, like, as we grow in numbers, which it's shown that we're growing in numbers. I think I saw a study just in the last month that showed, like, the baby boomer population, like, 4% of the population identified as strictly vegan. And then if you look at the Gen X population, it was 8%. And now the millennial population, it's saying 14%. So it's going up every year. And I think, you know, as the older generation, you know, it sounds maybe cold to say it, but like as the older generation dies off and the new generation grows up, I think more and more of the people in that generation are going to be vegan, and therefore more of their children will be vegan, and it'll just become more normal. And the more vegans you have in the world, the more vegan products we're going to have in the world. And like, yeah, eventually I think it'll just, we'll come to that 10% tipping point.
So without even realizing it, they all become vegan.
Yeah, I mean, it'll just become the normal thing to do, just like electric cars, you know? Yeah. I mean, I got my electric car in 2013, and I mean, I didn't see another Tesla in North Carolina for probably like a year. And I was so excited when I finally saw like another Tesla in the wild in Charlotte. I was like, oh, I was like rolling down my window and waving to them. I was so excited to see somebody who was like also an early adopter. Now I see Teslas quite a bit, you know, it's something that like when we can show people that they're not sacrificing anything, and that's what I think Tesla did with the electric car. Like it's still fast, it's sexy, it's fun to drive. It's got all that performance and it's electric. Like the electric is almost like the afterthought, right? It's still got everything. There's lots of people that buy Teslas just because they want a cool car. And then it's like an afterthought for them that is, oh, it's also the benefit that the car is green. I hope that that will be a similar thing that will happen with veganism, where it's like everybody at the table will be ordering like the vegan burger, the Impossible Burger, or the Beyond Meat Burger, whatever. And then if somebody like actually orders a real like dead animal burger, we'll all just kind of be like, really? Wow, it's so weird. I can't believe people still do that, you know? And that person will feel sort of, oh, you know, I'm participating in this, perpetuating this awful industry. And I also think it's just like ignorance, right? Like a lot of people don't know. I had a lot of people when Racing Extinction came out say, you know, I had no idea about the environmental impact of meat. I think Cowspiracy did a great job of telling that story. I think it's just, you know, there's a lot of unawareness out there. And I was part of that group too. Like I remember before I saw the movie The Cove, you know, I didn't know that the dolphin captivity industry was driving this horrible dolphin slaughter until I saw that film. I was absolutely clueless that there was any sort of, you know, problem there. And then of course, like from The Cove won the Academy Award and it became the most winning documentary of all time. And then Gabriella made Blackfish and Blackfish aired on CNN. And like the next day after Blackfish aired on CNN, SeaWorld lost $3 billion worth of market share the next day. One day you can look back at like the stock prices of SeaWorld and you can see the day that Blackfish aired on CNN because the stock price just like falls through the floor.
Yeah.
And it's continued to do nothing but go down. In fact, they hit their all-time low in stock value last week. And SeaWorld announced to their stockholders that they're going to stop paying their shareholders. So this is, you know, it came to that tipping point, right? Like Blackfish airing on CNN like 30 times to millions of people led to this huge protest of like, oh my God, I didn't know this is a problem. And then you saw it sort of infiltrate mainstream media. I mean, I remember even on The Daily Show with Jon Stewart or maybe it was last week with John Oliver, you know, they talked about Blackfish and about how like once you know that, I think the joke that they said was something like, once you know that the orca's pool is filled with tears, with whale tears, like you can't unknow that information. And like that Blackfish had become such a huge part of the national dialogue that it was making it into like late night talk shows and things like that. I'm hoping that the same sort of thing will happen with veganism. Like as we start to get people, like obviously there was a champion somewhere within CNN that saw Blackfish and said, you know what, we're going to air this and we're going to air it not just once, we're going to air it like 30 times in primetime television. We're going to make sure everyone in America sees this movie. And it has had a huge effect. I mean, it's single-handedly, I think, brought down, you know, a multi-billion dollar company. So I think we have the power to do stuff like that. It's that, how do we get it, these messages into the right places? How do we get Cowspiracy to be played on CNN? You know, how do we get Racing Extinction aired on Discovery Channel. So we had a big premiere, but like we haven't played 30 times the way that Blackfish did. So I think, you know, it's partially just education. And then it's partially like the older generation dying off. I think that will change us.
Yeah, which sort of sounds terrible, but a good thing.
But it's the reality, right?
Yeah, no, I understand. So do you think in the process of that, that there will be a, like with this improvement of awareness and caring more, obviously it's drawing us out of ourselves. At the moment, you know, we're still very fear-bound creatures. And psychologically, that means we live in a shrinked, you know, the more fearful we are, the more our reality shrinks. You know, we're in a smaller space internally. And globally, you know, we know that fear is at a high level, and anxiety, depression, things like that are on the rise. Psychological conditions, there's new ones emerging all the time, new phobias, new this, new that, more medication to cope with it. So we're kind of on a deterioration process. But, you know, when I hear you describing the world the way you're describing it, one can only hope that there's a healing in that that will change that as well. You know what I mean? That we start maybe feel better about ourselves in life when we start living with more integrity, you know, as a species. I think it's almost impossible for us to be healthy in the mind when we're justifying horrific things on the planet that are destructive to the planet, to ourselves, to animals, and to everyone around us, really. So, yeah, I was sort of visualizing that as you were talking, that, you know, we can only hope that there is going to be a healing process. Of course, maybe that needs to be proactive as well. You know, whether it be people like myself that understand the human mind, need to make sure that we're continuing this education to be aware, because we don't want to underestimate what we've come from and what we were. Mm-hmm. I think this change is real, and I think maybe that 10% theory, you know, holds water to some degree, and hopefully it will in this instance, that there will be that tipping point and it'll just take over. But we don't want to forget the forces at play that live deep within us. And I think that's what sometimes I find in these journeys, or, you know, we're talking like it's all great stuff, everything you're talking about, and it's inspiring, and I'm sure it will feed hope into anybody sort of listening rather than just seeing it in a down negative way. But I also feel we've got to be realistic about what we are as a species. And there is a kind of a weird darkness looming through everyone in some weird shape. And that's the stuff we don't talk about. You know, our little inner world of thoughts and desires, and, you know, we act like they're not there, and we all put on this lovely front for each other. You know, whether it be vegan or environmentalist, doesn't really matter. We've still got to get real about, I think, what we are for this to truly manifest, you know, because I think what you're talking about is possible. And I think if we all get real and keep getting real about everything, you know, about the whales, about the environment, and also about ourselves and what this is for us as people and what we're going to do to truly bring this to life. I just think it's essential that that's in the ingredient, because it's us that created all this. The only reason we need to create this change is because we created the mess. And right. And for us to make real change, we've got to get honest. This is like, let's just say individually, if you're dealing with one person's life, let's say you came to me and said, David, I'd like to see if there's more to me and expand myself and see if I can grow more and, you know, maybe feel more than I even thought I ever could. Well, one of the key starting points for anyone is you've got to clearly know where you're at, because otherwise it's like you're trying to navigate life from a misidentified starting point. So everything you do, even if it looks like you're doing the right thing, even if your intentions are good, it can end up creating more mess than what you started with. And that's what we're seeing happening on the planet. No matter how much effort we put in, every solution creates new problems in the main. That's been the flow of the past of us. And hopefully, you know, we can change that so we actually live in a more aware space. Because otherwise, what the danger I see is we're the same people that created the mess in the first place trying to solve. So what makes us think that this time we're going to do it right? Or we're just going to another mess in a new disguise kind of thing? So I think it's very important that this time we do it properly, and that this is it. You know what I mean? This is you and I are living in the time of the awakening of a new direction for humanity. And I think for that to manifest, we've got to get very, very real about the nature of our existence. And because there is a forces within us that are very primitive. And I think that is, you know, when you talk about, you know, the old generation sort of dying off in a sense in terms of their mentality, I think what we're really talking about is the dying off of the whole history of human existence. Our whole way of being throughout the history of humanity has been violent and controlling and not very pleasant. And if you really dig, you know, under the surface, it's a big deal, you know, like it is a big deal what we've done, and it's a big deal what we're doing. So I think a complete transformation is required. And, you know, and hopefully in that, you know, the kind of work that you do, and there's a lot of people doing stuff, fortunately, that within that, that we can also see the truth and face that. Because otherwise what we're going to do is, whether it be individually or collectively, we're going to try and create change from a misidentified starting point where we haven't been honest enough. And if you bend it at all, you know, like I can tell you with an individual, if they create some little perceptual shift to see themselves the way they would like to rather than the truth, then they end up just chasing their tail, and doesn't matter what they do, that you can't really shift yourself. So I think that applies to us collectively as well. I think we collectively have to get very honest, and you know, we got a lot of work to do, obviously, to create that. But I think if we can do that, then I think everything you're talking about will come to life. And I think that tipping point will happen, and then we'll be able to roll with it. But if that tipping point comes, but we still don't understand ourselves enough, then we might just roll into another era of confusion. And then it might be too late to do anything about it, because the planet might not be able to wear it anymore, or who knows what we've done by that point. And so just for interest, from your observation with people and life, and where do you feel that we're at? Obviously, you're, you know, in the midst of it and seeing a lot of growth. Are you finding that the overall feeling from your point of view is that this is going to happen? Or do you think that we do need to dig deeper? Do you think I'm off track, for example, a doomsday guy saying, oh, David, you know, let's not talk negatively about humans? Or do you think this is real, that we do need to look at the darker truth of our existence and to why we've become so cruel in the first place?
Yeah, no, I mean, I try and be as positive as I can possibly be, because I think it helps me get people on board more. Like if I'm super depressing and I'm just like telling people about how all of the negative things that are happening, because as an environmental activist, I mean, there's bad news every day. And then we'll get like, you know, one good news item. And I try and make sure that when I'm sharing stuff on my pages, on social media, I'm talking to people, I'm trying to balance it between like scaring the shit out of them and like being honest, like, right, you said be honest,
yeah,
versus like giving them hope. And I have had moments where I just completely just felt that we were past the tipping point and we were screwed. Like I made a couple of trips to the BP oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico in 2010. And there was one point where I was out in the oil spill, and I could see like crude oil floating from horizon to horizon in the middle of the ocean. And I was 75 miles away from where the Deepwater Horizon sank. And I remember just feeling like overwhelmed, and that I was going to like fall on the floor of the boat in tears. And I couldn't, because there was a woman on the boat that fell to the ground before me. And so I ended up like comforting her. She had lived through Hurricane Katrina. They were just trying to rebuild. Her husband, you know, took people out on boat tours, and she knew that like their livelihood was over. And I came back from that. I just remember like coming back from that so depressed. And I was doing like a Skype interview like we're doing now. And I think I was just being really negative, I guess. And I remember just the person on the other side just being like, yeah, but I mean, we need to be a little bit positive too, right? And I kind of like snapped out of it, and I could just see from their face, they were like, this is not good. You're just going to run everybody away from the movement because you're being so like doomsday. So, I mean, I have those moments too. But I feel like in the past couple of years, I've got more hope, like seeing electric cars taking off, seeing solar take off. I've got solar on my roof. Like I haven't been to a gas station since September 2013. Just the fact that that is a reality, and that when I'm driving around my town of Charlotte, that I'm using like free power that's landed on my roof from the sunshine every day, like that, it's real. It's not like this pie in the sky idea that I'm reading about, like, oh yeah, someday we'll be able to drive off of the power of sunshine. Like I'm doing it, and I've been doing it for a few years now. So when the solutions become more of a reality, I think it's given me more hope. But one of the things, I mean, since you said we should be honest, one of the things that I really think we need to talk about that I don't feel like enough of humanity is talking about, especially the environmental community, is human population. When I was in college studying biology, I had a biochemistry professor that one day, you know, I went into class and he basically said, you know, everybody close your books. We're not going to talk about biochemistry today. This was at UC San Diego. He just said, I'm going to show you guys a film about human population. And I remember just being like completely devastated by the video and walking with the professor after that class, like all the way across our college campus, talking about human population. And I really, you know, made the decision that day that I was not going to have children. And my husband and I are child-free by choice. And I've started to sort of talk about this issue in like the last 6 months or so. I was doing a question and answer session in Vail after a screening of Racing Extinction. And one of the women in the audience during the Q&A asked me, you know, is there something in the film that you guys didn't address that you wish that you had? And I said, yeah, population. And I talked about the video and I talked about how, you know, we're at 7.4 billion people right now with a growth rate of over 200,000 people per day. It's not sustainable. Our planet is finite. We have a certain amount of resources and we cannot, the carrying capacity of the earth is not going to be able to handle the demand at the rate that we're going in population growth. And, you know, a lot of ecologists have studied this, and the most common number that I've seen that like the earth can handle carrying capacity wise with all those humans living in relative prosperity. Of course, there's a difference between like the human impact of a person in India versus the United States. We have a much bigger carbon footprint in the developed nations. All the people living in relative prosperity, the carrying capacity, many ecologists believe is close to 2 billion. And we're already at 7.4 billion, projected to reach like 10 billion by 2050. So this is something that I think we need to be talking about. I think if people, you know, one of the things that I like to bring up, because I know there's people out there that just have this inherent like want and need to be a parent and want to be a father, want to be a mother. You know, there's 132 million orphaned children in the world that are looking for a home. And I talked about this at a clean energy conference in Aspen a few months ago. And I brought up the orphans. And when I, you know, left my speech, I was going to talk about like the standard stuff. I talk about solutions, preaching not to the choir, you know, my activism through racing. And that day, for whatever reason, I just decided to throw out the whole thing. And I just talked about population. And I had this young girl, like early 20s, come running up to me in the hotel. And she just gave me a huge hug. And she said, thank you so much for talking about the orphans. Because I'm an orphan, and if my mom had had her own children, she never would have found me. And then later on that night, she found me again with another one of her friends who is also an adopted girl. And I feel like that's a really important discussion that I feel like a lot of people don't want to talk about it. It's like an uncomfortable subject. And I definitely, the few times that I've brought it up, I've seen, you know, maybe like 2/3 of the audience are like nodding and like clapping and like, oh, thank you for bringing this up. This is really important. We need to talk about this. And then I see like the other third, like sort of uncomfortably like shift in their chairs and like their body language changes. And like, I just immediately feel this sort of defensive pose coming from them. So it's certainly a sensitive subject, but I feel like it's one of the ones that we need to talk about. And I'm sort of sick of how a lot of the environmental community and people that are like talking about saving the planet are just totally flat out ignoring that we're adding 200,000 people to the planet every day. Even if all of the people on the planet are vegan, driving electric cars, using solar, it is not sustainable for us to keep adding that many people every single day. We just don't have enough resources. So that's something I think that needs to be at the forefront of the conversation and currently is not.
So what has that been for you then on a personal level? Because obviously this all gets down to the fact we're all individuals that have to deal with this. So from your side as a woman? Is it you having to resist the desires, or are they just not driving you, or is it just the reality of life on Earth just takes away any confusion, so it's not a choice? Where's it sitting with you on an emotional level as a woman, knowing that you're not going to do that very thing that we're programmed to do? And that is to keep creating new human beings and churn them out, which, as we can see in the face of the fact that the planet, you know, potentially, who knows, we may pull this off, we may not. It's not clear yet. We've done a lot of damage. Has the planet already worn too much? I don't know. You know, we're going to find out the hard way probably, and hopefully that's not the case. But obviously it's questionable about bringing children into the planet for multiple reasons, let alone the fact, like you said, there's just too many and there's children that desperately need love and homes. So I'm with you on that 100%. I mean, I haven't had a child, and yet I loved the idea of being a father, and I've certainly ended up sort of being a father to, you know, helping other people in many ways, but not in the traditional way that one would imagine that a father would look like. And I'm quite content with that, because as long as I'm giving and helping others that need it, then that's what's important. But on a personal level for you, where does that sit for you? As a woman on planet Earth and not partaking in the normal route that a woman maybe would walk down.
Right. So I never had that. I never actually had that sort of biological clock thing. And certainly, like, this, you know, this video that I was shown, you know, this is probably my second or third year of college. So, you know, I would have been 20, 21 years old when I saw that. You know, would my biological clock have kicked in if I had not seen this video when I was 21 and just been completely devastated by it? I don't know. But I remember growing up, like, that I never sort of, like, dreamed about, like, having kids. And but yet I have one of my three older sisters, like, she always wanted to be a mother. And it was, you know, it was, like, in her. It was in her blood that she wanted to be a parent. So I think, you know, I don't know if that's an evolutionary reaction to overpopulation, because I meet a lot of women that are like, yeah, I never had that desire either. Like, I'm totally fine and happy not having children and being child free. And, you know, there are ecological reactions when a population becomes overpopulated. And, you know, one of those things could possibly be that internal instinct, you know, that maybe I was supposed to have, that I wanted to breed and have kids, like, was suppressed in some way because, you know, Mother Nature or evolution is realizing, like, hey, we need to slow down this process. Good example is the kiwi bird, you know, the kiwi bird in New Zealand, which, you know, it was isolated on this island and did not have any natural enemies. So it developed a very, very slow breeding process. Like, they only have one chick, and it's like every year, every 2 years. It's a very slow process of growing because the population adapted to the fact that if we, you know, have 20 kiwi bird chicks every year, like, we're going to overpopulate our little island and we won't be able to function. So they developed this really slow way of breeding. And of course, then when humans got there and dogs and cats, and they started to get killed and they're getting run over by cars, you know, now they're endangered and they're in trouble because now they have all these enemies, but they've evolved in a way that breeds very slowly because they evolved in an ecosystem where they had no enemies. So in essence, their own breeding and instincts sort of changed to their situation. So is that changing within humans? Are humans starting to, you know, have a biological, instinctual, hormonal reaction to the fact that there's too many of us on the planet and more women and men are being born and saying, oh, you know, I don't think I want to have kids. There was a Time magazine article. It was a cover story. And actually, they dedicated the entire issue. It was probably two, maybe 3 years ago. And the cover of the magazine is like, you know, a couple, a young couple, just laying on a beach with sunglasses on and like cocktails. And it said, you know, the title of the cover story was "The Child-Free Life: When Having It All Means Not Having Children." And then the entire inside of the magazine was dedicated to all these different journalists and people that were voicing their opinion on why, you know, they had sort of chosen to have a child-free life. and it was the most downloaded and the most bought Time magazine of all time. Mm. So that tells you, I think, and that was a couple of years ago. This is not recent. I think that tells you that this is something that's like growing within our society. I know that, you know, I know quite a few women that are child free by choice, and many of them are older than me. I'm 42. And they said, you know, it's always been something I've felt weird about. I always felt like I was not normal, and I always felt like I was getting looks from my friends or looks from people when I would say that, you know, I didn't have kids. You know, sometimes you'll get like the pity reaction where they're like, oh, and I'm like, no, it's my choice. Like we've chosen not to have children. So now when people ask me if I have kids, I actually always say, we're actually child-free by choice. And I add the by choice on purpose. And that is to sort of offer up, if they're curious and they do want to know why I made that choice, I can bring it up. So I do feel like this is sort of like the next big issue we need to talk about. I mean, it's just stupid math, right? It doesn't take a genius to look at like the number of people and how fast we're growing and a finite, you know, our pale blue dot, and go, huh, okay, this is not sustainable. And it's actually a fairly like simple solution. There's many environmental issues that we have that are not solved easily. They're much more complicated, you know, like shifting energy, and they're much more complicated answers. Whereas, you know, there's simple, there are environmental problems that are very, very simple, like overfishing. All we have to do is just not be pulling out, you know, so many of the fish and let them breed enough that their populations can recover. We can't even do that, even when we know that we're depleting the ocean of these fish. So it's a simple solution, and yet countries, you know, there's a great film called End of the Line that's specifically just about overfishing, and you can see the scientists are just so frustrated because they're like, this is actually like one of the simplest environmental problems that we have, and we know the answer, and it's just not pulling as many fish out. And yet all these countries are like lying on their quotas and taking more than they are supposed to. And it's, you know, eventually probably going to cause a lot of these species to go extinct. It's the same simple math, I think, with human overpopulation. It's easy for us to realize like, okay, if I'm going to have kids, I'm going to adopt. I'm not going to have any. I'm going to have one, or I'm going to have two, one to replace myself and one to replace my spouse. And that alone would sort of stop the population from growing so much. And it, you know, a lot of it is too, like, you know, we need education. We need people to have access to contraceptive pills and, you know, prevention of contraception. And it does show actually that like education of women, the more educated that a woman has, it's actually a linear relationship between the amount of education and the number of children that she has. So the more education a woman has, the less likely she is to have children. So that's got to be part of the equation as well. But I just read this beautiful article by a bioethicist named Travis Reeder that's out of Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. He had an article come out on National Public Radio maybe like a month ago, and the title of it was, Should We Be Having Children in the Age of Climate Change? And it had a huge, huge response. It got like something like 70,000 shares on Facebook. And then he wrote a follow-up article sort of addressing all the criticisms of that original NPR article. So I just read that last night, and he talked about how, you know, there is this argument of, you know, look what we've done to the planet and look at what's coming our way. Like, essentially, you know, we've put the planet in a situation that's pretty dire. And our kids and our kids' kids are going to be dealing with all the sort of crap that we are handing to them. It's all our problems, and we're just sort of handing it off to them and hoping, you know, they're going to be able to solve it. And so his argument was, you know, ethics wise, is it not more of a ethical decision to make to take care of the people that are already alive and existing on the planet than it is to bring new life onto the planet? Are we not protecting our children by not having them? And should we not use the resources that we have and the love we have to give to people that are already here on Earth and living in horrible situations, rather than bringing in new life, because we're not harming kids that we don't have. If you don't have a child, then, you know, you're not harming them. But if you ignore a person that's already on the earth and needs help and is struggling and suffering, then you are causing them harm by not helping them. Mm. So is it not more ethically sound for us to decide to take care of the people and the children that are already here than it is for us to justify bringing new people onto the earth when there already is such a struggle for so many billions of people on the planet living without, you know, access to clean water and food and all those things. So I thought it was a fascinating article. I can't remember what the second article was called, but anyways, the bioethicist's name is Travis Reeder, so you can Google it. But I found it to be a fascinating sort of look at the problem, and I agreed with everything he said.
Yeah, and hopefully this will come from, you know, like conscious awareness. Like you're talking yourself from a very aware, conscious space, you know, probably in a far more expansive space of awareness than the average person might be on the planet at the moment. You know, one way would be to create new laws. Let's say globally all the world leaders came to terms with what you're saying, and it's like, of course, do the maths. 1 + 1 = 2. We need to. So next thing, we have global laws saying that we're not allowed to have children. Of course, and I think that that's not the way to go. I'd like to think that it can come from, you know, the pathway that you've discovered, which is just common sense and awareness, where we can see that we need to hold back on our own personal desires for a while and stop making this about us all the time and get real about the fact that every individual's behavior is contributing to the outcomes we're seeing, because everyone thinks it's someone else. You know, it's not them. Right. Or I'm just having one child, I'm not causing any trouble, or, you know, because in their little microcosm of life, it doesn't feel like a big deal.
Right.
But, you know, you add it all up and it adds up to a big deal. So right. Hopefully, yes, we can do this without more laws and enforcement, because I'm personally just about over all the new laws we create every day on this planet of controls and domination. And we've got governments always telling us what to do, like we're, you know, not too bright or something. So hopefully, yes, just individuals like yourself speaking up and talking this way is enough to start I think a new way of being where it's not a government controlled world, and it's just it's a world led by awareness and intelligence and consciousness, is ultimately what we need to create a real shift and a sustainable shift, because obviously sustainability is essential. And I think true sustainability means we have to create a sustainable way of being in here. Right. And if we can create that, then everything we do will make sense. And at the moment, the world we see is a reflection of the way we think. So if we work out how to make this environment sustainable, then I think we can make a sustainable one externally. And I think all these topics, you know, are bringing this forth, and it gets us thinking more and more aware and pulls us out of ourself, which is one of the keys here. I think we've been trapped in ourself for too long. So I think that's one of the, you know, the important movements for us. So with the population thing and having children and not having children, did you want to say something? Right.
I did actually. Yep. So while you were talking, I just brought up, because I wanted to make sure that I got the numbers right.
Yep.
But in that article, the NPR article, Should We Be Having Kids in the Age of Climate Change? One of the things that they did was they did a comparison of carbon emissions. So they broke down different examples of how much carbon dioxide in metric tons that is saved over a lifetime by a typical American making certain actions, including not having one child. So by increasing your car's fuel economy from 20 to 30 miles per gallon, you're saving 148 metric tons. By reducing miles driven from 231 to 155 per week, you're reducing your carbon footprint by 147 metric tons. By replacing your single glazed windows with energy efficient windows, you're saving 121 metric tons of carbon dioxide. By replacing 10 75-watt incandescent bulbs with 25-watt energy-efficient lights, you're saving 36 metric tons of carbon dioxide. By replacing your old refrigerator with an energy-efficient model, you're saving 19 metric tons. By recycling newspapers, magazines, glass, plastic, aluminum, and steel cans, you're saving 17 metric tons of carbon dioxide. And if you reduce the number of children by just one, With those emissions fixed at 2005 per capita values, you are saving 9,441 metric tons of carbon dioxide. So it's a huge, huge, like all of, basically if you're an environmentalist and then you go out and you have six kids, it's like, it's negating all of the other stuff that you're doing. Mm. I found that graph to be really, really powerful. So yeah, I'm sure this is going to, you know, this sort of like information is not going to be welcomed by some environmentalists, but it's because it's the truth and it's going to, you know, make them take a good look at like some of the decisions they're making.
Yeah. And I think, you know, the truth is what's going to heal us. It's not your opinion or my opinion or anyone's opinion. It's the truth is the only thing that can do this. And it has to be that way because, you know, there's no point anyone following anybody anymore. I think, you know, we are followers as a species, and that's what, you know, perhaps people with more corrupt minds, and which is not their fault necessarily, but that's where they've ended up, take advantage of that fact. And they see that. I remember like being at school, you know, I've told this story before, but, you know, we had a guy that was like a little Hitler running around, and he was just a beast of a kid, and God knows what has happened to the poor kid in his home life. I don't know why he was like that, but he took pleasure in controlling everyone. As it turned out, he dated the headmaster's daughter. He was the top cricket player, and he also loved smashing people in the head when they're studying and doing stuff like that. So he was a nasty piece of works. Now, nearly the majority of my year at school went along with him. They didn't partake in it, but they would be his friend, and they would go with the flow. So he was taking advantage of this weakness in us in a way that we don't stand up for ourselves. You know, we'll just go with the flow, follow the trends, do what everyone else is doing. And this is why I think in this movement, it's so important that as much as I can hear you, that's what's going to get us going maybe. There's going to be a lot of that 90% that just sit there and let the bully do what the bully does. So if suddenly the 90% have a new 10% of leadership, then they might follow that because that becomes the new way of being. But I think in that, we've got to make sure that it's not following anymore, that we got to get every individual to empower up, because otherwise they're not alive. You know, they're not truly embracing life. They're not feeling it to the depth that we can feel it. They're not sharing with truth and honesty. They're just following again. And then we're just like little robots, you know, walking around the planet. And I think this is our chance to truly wake up and maybe, yes, stop having children, let's prove that we can actually take care of what we've got. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The planet, the children that exist, the animals that exist, you know, like dog breeding. There's so many dogs that need homes. Like in Adelaide, we, you know, the RSPCA is our organization that's meant to be all creatures great and small, but they also put their stamp of approval on certain chickens you can buy, you know, with their heads chopped off, and they're meant to care about all creatures great and small, and they put dogs down every day that can't find a home. So, you know, obviously we've got to create something which is real this time. You know, I think we've been stuffing around forever on this planet, making out we're good and being good in little areas here and then hiding our sickness over here. And I think it's once and for all, we need to just pull the, you know, the bullshit curtain across, and let's just get real and make this happen for real. And I think that's what I feel is lacking a little bit in that there's a lack of awareness of what's going to be required to step into that space. Because, I mean, you come across as someone that is getting real. And I think that that's essential. So to me, I don't see you making choices. I see you living true to the information that life is presenting to you. And that takes choice out of the equation. You know, it makes it quite straightforward. It's like, well, of course I can't partake in that. Or of course I can't eat animals. They suffer. They're sentient beings. This is ludicrous. You know, so we can see that it's obvious what we need to do. But it's got to come from within. It's got to come from a place of self-awakening and self-empowerment. You know, on a global level, you know, is to me the key.
Do you feel like, I feel like social media has sort of, I love the fact that it's sort of given everybody a voice. Like, you don't need to have your own, like, you know, article in it or column in a newspaper. Mm. You don't need to be a professional journalist. Mm. You know, you don't need to have like some sort of media credential to be able to like post something on the internet now that can actually like end up spreading, you know, to millions of people. If you have a smartphone, you know, you've got a camera, you've got a video camera on it, you have access to the internet, you know, you've got access to Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all these things. And so I do feel like there's something about social media that sort of empowered everyone can kind of have a voice now in a way that, you know, before you sort of, before social media, like if you wanted to get your message out to a lot of people, you'd have to get yourself in the newspaper or get yourself in the magazine. You'd have to find a journalist that was willing to like help you tell your story and get it out there. So automatically a whole bunch of people are not able to, you know, reach out and get their message out there. So I think social media has like, that's been a really positive effect of it, that everybody can have an effect and has the possibility of like their post going viral and millions of people finding out about, you know, this certain struggle of someone and helping out, you know, and in some cases they end up raising, you know, millions of dollars to help a certain cause. But you having studied psychology, you know, when you were saying like, you want everybody to be self-empowered and you want people to stop following. Is that like, do you see that as being like a realistic thing? Because isn't that so ingrained in our DNA? Like you said, we're followers. Like we gravitate towards other people that we feel like, oh, he or she is a leader. And, you know, I'm going to listen to what they say and be influenced by someone that for whatever reason we admire. And we see like a strength that we don't see in ourselves. Is that like, I mean, is that like so ingrained in our human nature that there are automatically going to be like those A-type personalities that are the leaders? Mm. And then, you know, the alpha and like the beta personalities that are just automatically going to be looking for people to sort of lead them because they're not brave enough to like be the ones that are going to do something drastic or do something different than the rest of the population. Cause I do feel like it's so ingrained for people to want to fit in, right? They want to be accepted and they don't want to be weird. But, I mean, and that whole study about the hotels, like that's a great example, right? Yeah. It was most effective to tell people that they were going to be like the majority if they didn't wash their linens. Like that's what made them change. Not money, not the environment, but like fitting in with their peers and being more like the other people that had stayed at the hotel, even though those people weren't in the room with them. That's what I found was really interesting about that. But I mean, like, I just don't know if that's like just a part of like human nature. And there's just going to be a lot of people that aren't comfortable with like being a loud voice.
Yeah. You know, look, at, I mean? At the moment, yes, that is the way it is. And it is ingrained in us. But my best answer I could give to the question is to put the human brain like on the table as in a sort of a vision and to look at it as a machine and okay, how does that machine function? And when that machine is guided by fear, which is, I think a completely, to me, like, there's a lot of topics we need to talk about. I think one of the most important ones is the nature of fear, because I think it's one of the most misunderstood things on the planet. We tend to see fear as something we feel in extreme situations or, you know, when we're really nervous or really scared of something or when we get anxiety, all those extreme type emotional experiences. To me, the entire functioning of human thought, including this need to follow, it's all driven by fear. I think our entire reality is a fear-created reality. So when I work with people, there's nothing. I don't try and fix people or sort out their pre-existing history to make it right. Because what is, and none of it's real anyway. It's kind of like just an illusion held together by fear. Because fear creates an emotional response to life that leads to certain types of behavior, and it leads to the behavior of following it. Because ultimately, fear makes us more insecure. Fear makes us feel weaker. So here we are with this powerful us inside that's calling out for more, but it's calling out for more within a fear-based system. And that fear-based system creates this weird outcome where we kind of reach out in weird little scared ways and where it's easier to follow than it is to stand up in the truth. And to stand up in the truth takes some courage compared to following. So following always becomes the easy answer, let alone taking that route like, you know, being like at school, the guy that actually goes against the flow of everybody, says no to the bully and says no to the followers and like, come on, everyone, this is not good enough, which is ultimately now what, you know, what what happened at school is still happening on the planet. And, you know, I'm 54 now. I went to school a long time ago. In essence, the nature of how we function hasn't changed at all. You know, what I saw at school is exactly what's happening in the bigger picture on in society. And the bullies are just, you know, in bigger jobs. You know, they might be the president. I don't know. It could be anybody.
Or hopefully not be the president.
Well, hopefully not. But that's what happens, you know. We they just got new jobs and new disguises, but ultimately it's about control, and then everyone follows. And then we just go along with the flow. Even if our leaders are leading us into hell, oh yeah, we'll follow you there, that's fine, as long as our individual lives are okay. So I think it's about addressing the fact that we are a lot more scared and insecure than we like to admit. Because fear, you know, when you're talking about, you know, seeing that the oil spillage, was that what you're talking about when you were crying? Or that other woman, you felt like crying and the woman cried and that left you a bit angry, and then you did your Skype interview and there was a little bit of attitude for like, you know, geez, what's going on? But I think ultimately it's not about, you know, I think we've got to get out how we feel and be honest about how we feel. But if you're not fearful, then you can stand up and talk about this stuff. And I don't think that's being doomsday or negative. Then we don't have to actually think about whether we're being positive or negative, because we're not talking from fear. That only comes into play when we're in a fear-based thinking reality. And in a fear-based way, we're always careful and we're always trying to think of outcomes. Is that going to offend this person? Will that do this? Will that do this? So we're like crazy, right? We're gone mad because we're always overanalyzing everything. And I think when you remove fear from the brain, and I can tell you, it's instantaneous. When I can get someone to a space where they're in a fearless state and just a pure conscious state, everything that they thought was a problem disappears. They can handle things. They can look at things clearly. There's nothing to figure out anymore. So I think we're caught up in a bit of an illusion that we need to figure out. Even all these problems on the planet, I think if we all just calm down, completely calm down, and just stop rattling ahead so quick and just had a look at it, I think it'd be this is well within our capability to heal this situation, to heal the planet, to be sensible and intelligent and aware about how we approach it. But we're not going to do that when fear is guiding the system, because fear will never, ever allow this to happen. And this is one thing, say, I see in the vegan movement. They may have become aware of caring for things beyond self, but their fear levels are maybe even higher than the average normal human being. More insecure, more disturbed.
Why do you say that?
Because they never dealt with their pain leading into becoming a vegan. This is a generalization, but it's still truth. Generalization doesn't mean it's not true. It's still an observable fact. And they haven't, because we haven't been taught that. This is not part of society yet. We see you go to, you know, a counselor or a psychologist when you're messed up, as opposed to we all need to be learning this stuff right from the beginning. You know, we all should be learning how to understand our minds and how they work, where our thoughts and feelings come from, how fear interplays in there and creates an internal conceptual reality, and that's just a, you know, a shell to live in until you know how to bust out and be a free-spirited being. So you don't need a guidance system anymore. You are the guidance. You guide your own reality. So I see in the vegan movement that they haven't learned how to deal with their pain, which is no fault of their own. And then they discover that the world is a lot worse than they ever thought. And they wake up to seeing things in a new way. And then every day they become, this is where social media can sort of turn both ways. I think it's essential. I agree with you 100%. I think it's going to be the key to how we're going to get this to happen. But there's a lot of people that get lost in there, and they're constantly watching videos of animals suffering, and it's horrific. Like if I go onto Facebook, I instantly go to my page because I don't want to see all the feeds that come up, because there'll be a baby goat where someone's put petrol on its head and laughing their head off while it runs around with its head burning, or, you know, it's all the time there's insane things happen. So if you're a caring person, you've woken up to the needs of animals, this will feed into your pre-existing pain. And now you don't realize it, but now you want to fight to stop this. But they don't. What they're really fighting for is their own pain in many ways. I'm not saying they don't care about the animals, but it's got very confused and mixed up. And then they often become quite weak and insecure in the process of it, even more than they were before. So you can see the danger of not dealing with our fear whilst trying to face the realities that we're looking at, whether it be the environment, the animal issue, you know, starving children, children that are orphans, whatever the case may be, overpopulation, there is that huge risk that if we keep looking at through our minds in an insecure state, we're going to create an insecure response. And that insecure response is not what we're looking for. We're looking for a confident, powerful, expansive, open-minded, clear-thinking, calm response to the situation. And in a state of insecurity, we can't do that. And nearly everyone is in, look, it's not hard to see how insecure humans are. I can just go down right now, sit in a clear coffee shop area where there's people everywhere, and all you got to do is look in people's eyes and they dart away. They're scared. You know, we can't even talk to each other. We can barely really look at each other. You know, that's the truth. We can stare at our phones for ages, but we're not good at even looking at each other and talking right. to each other. You know, and someone like yourself, you're an exception to the rule. You know, you're a great communicator. You're open. You explore. You don't settle for just this information. You keep looking for more. But that's not the case. So you're pushing out, whereas right. most people are very inward in their realities, and they don't know that they are, because in their own world, they're telling themselves all sorts of things, and you know, combining wishing they were more and in denial about how insecure they really are, and it's just this big mass of confusion. And then we hide that with our clothes and our hair and our makeup and our fashion and our this and our cars and you name it. You know, we do whatever we can to hide the truth. So, mm-hmm. you know, we need to pull these masks off to see where we're actually at. And I'm telling you, it's a lot worse than we'd like to think.
I agree with that.
Yeah. We're a mess of insecurity and psychological, you know, neurosis. We're all over the place. That's like that classic interview that I don't know whether you saw Russell Brand on NBN or something, and he was interviewed by three of their top, you know, anchors that do the thing in the morning news program. And it's
what is the name of the channel? I'm going to look this up.
Oh, you've got to look it up. It's one of the funniest things you'll ever see. Okay. Russell Brand, something Joe, right, NBN or Joe interview or something like that. I can't remember the exact name, but it should be there. It's one of the key ones. And he's been interviewed by a blonde woman and some English woman and this guy.
Russell Brand hilariously embarrasses morning show host?
Yes, that's it. Yes.
Okay.
Now, it's a classic, because what it exposes is just how... So here's people in top jobs, right? They're in seriously... jobs in society, sharing information with the planet, and that part of the information they share is a huge influence on this majority that we talk about that just follow. And here they are doing it while they're just, he exposes their insecurities within seconds. Like they fall apart, and he's really not doing a whole bunch. He's, because he's sitting in a more open space, he's exposed himself. He's admitted who he is. He's admitted his weirdness. He's admitted that he used to take drugs. So he's got nothing to hide. So you put right. a human that has nothing to hide around a whole bunch of humans that have a shitload of stuff to hide, they fall apart very quickly. And this is what I think, you know, we need to get real that this is what's going on. And how are we going to address enormous issues on this planet when the truth is we're all scared little golems running around that you know, can't even admit it. And we're too scared to admit it because someone might take advantage of it. Or put us down and make us feel even worse than we currently do. But that clip is a classic, and it just like, you know, I forget his statement. He said something about, he said, so you guys are like a hotbed of neurosis or something, you know, and they're all like going all weird and, you know, admitting how messed up they are and all this kind of stuff. And it was just, you know, it's a classic. But that's what we that's need, awesome. You know, and at least Russell is kind of stirring the pot and bringing out some more truth. But I just think that we, you know, rather than just leaving it that as funny, because it is funny in the moment, we need to look deeper into really, let's get real with each other and stop avoiding that. You know, let's stop avoiding how insecure we really are, or that we even, just simple stuff. I think, you know, we look in the mirror, and how weird is that we look at ourselves and care, you know, we're a bit self-obsessed and we care what we look like, for goodness sake. We'll know
it's because the rest of the world like judges us so much on that, right?
Well, of course, but then we buy into it, right? And and this is where I think we've got to find our strength.
But like you kind of have to. Like, I mean, like so let's just, for example, let's look at my racing career. So it costs millions of dollars for me to drive these race cars. I mean, it's not a cheap sport. I have to raise the money to do it.
Yep.
I'm in a much more like difficult situation than most drivers because I have, you know, my ethical rules, right? So I don't work with any companies that produce fossil fuels. So no oil, no coal, no natural gas, no nuclear. I don't work with any companies that produce meat or dairy products or companies that test on animals. And so, or fur or leather. So that's like right off the bat, like I've eliminated like 90% of the sponsors that are in racing. So I'm already kind of, you know, pulling from a pool of sponsors that feel the same way as I do about the planet. And, you know, so the people I'm talking to are like solar companies and wind power companies, but I'm having to like, you know, present myself to be able to help them talk to the public. So like, if I, you know, didn't take care of myself and didn't try and look nice when I go to the meetings, I mean, that's going to hurt my career. It's going to have an effect on like, am I actually able to do the thing that I feel is making the most difference, which is trying to get out there in a race car in front of, you know, 75 million race fans and talk to them about solar power or talk to them, you know, show them that like I drove an electric car all the way to my race and like, you know, long distance electric road trips are happening now. It's not a difficult thing to make happen. Or, you know, I've had Blackfish on my car and the Cove, and then we give away DVDs of the movies at the races. And then people are learning about the dolphin captivity industry and they're stopping buying tickets to SeaWorld and places like that. So like, you know, part of the reason I think that people are obsessed with that is that that's like, the world judges you on that. Like no matter what, that whole, oh, don't judge a book by its cover. I mean, but that's why books have covers, because we judge them by the covers. You know, otherwise it just all start on page one, like with the text.
Yeah.
Then that's like the only way that people cannot judge a book by a cover. If it actually, none of them had covers, that's what we would have to do.
Yes.
And I think, you know, and I don't think like social media has helped that, right? Because now we're out there so much more. Now we're really like, you know, people are doing live videos. And I remember the first time I did like a live feed and I was like sort of nervous. I was like, oh, like, so if I screw up, like I can't go back and like correct it and reshoot it and then present this like nice polished version of what I want to say. If I make a mistake, you know, it's pretty out there. And I remember like thinking like, oh, this is like different doing something live where I can't correct any sort of mistake or flub up.
Yep.
And then like at some point you just sort of are like, you know what, who cares? Like at some point you're just like, well, whatever, I'm human. I'm going to screw up some of my sentences or choose the wrong word or whatever. And that's okay because everybody else does it too. And in fact, like we're all human and we all screw up sometimes. And it sort of allows you to like let go of that. Like it, I have to present this perfect sort of thing to the world. Well, and I think that is a good thing. But like a lot of people obviously like they're probably not doing live videos because they have the fear of like, oh, I'm going to say something wrong and then it's out there. And so they're not doing it.
Huge.
It's a freeing feeling for sure to like let go of it. Cause you know, I had done videos before, but I hadn't really done the live thing. And once you do the live thing, you're like, okay, well, whatever, I guess. You know, I'm going to screw up and it's okay. Like it makes it like, so you realize like, oh, it's okay if I screw up, everybody screws up. And that allows you to sort of let go of it. Like I remember when I first gave speeches, I was very nervous. Oh, you're going on stage, right? And there's all this whole room of people that are just like sitting there, like staring at you. And you're like, okay, so I have to make sure that like I present something that's worthwhile. Here's all these people like, you know, taking their time to sit in these chairs. I don't want them to be bored and like annoyed that I'm wasting their time or whatever. So you're like thinking about it. And then, you know, as time went on, I just got more and more comfortable and I kind of let go of it. The problem is that a lot of people are never put in that situation where they sort of are forced to get over their fear. So then they never get over the fear. So they're like, oh, I'm terrified. Like I have sisters that are terrified of public speaking and they like they don't like to speak publicly, even if it's just like a room of, you know, 50 people or 30 people, because they've never been forced to sort of like get over that like fear of having all these eyes on them and people like, you know, what are you going to say? And that's sort of intimidating at first, but then once you do it a few times, then I think you kind of let go of it and you're like, oh, it doesn't matter. Like, I don't know.
No, look, I mean, it's all true because, I mean, all that, yes, it does come from a lot of judgment from society, but we end up being our own judge. Like, in the end, that's where it ends up sitting. We end up just becoming our own, you know, courtroom and judge, and we have a police force in there, and we enforce that on ourselves, and we put ourselves in jail, effectively. And then when you're in jail, you know, you're acting like it's the world that's put you there when it's you that's put you there. So, of course, you always feel like a victim. And then when you feel like a victim, you're more insecure. And then, of course, you're terrified to do everything. You're terrified to public speak or to be not looking attractive or to be seen not at your best. Or, I mean, one of the ways I've approached life is just to go for it. You know, like, I don't know, like when I do speeches, for example, I never prepare a speech. I just go up on stage, there's a mic in front of me, and I never have a clue what I'm going to say or even if I will have something to say, you know, and I take that chance and I figure, come on, let the environment inspire me. Let's see what comes out of me based on where I am, the people in front of me, and let's see what happens, rather than me sitting there the whole morning rehearsing my speech, getting all the words right. Right, here we go. And then irrespective of who's listening, I'm going to say the same speech. So I figure let's just go with the flow more. Let's give, you know, we're very tight as a species. And I think we need to loosen up. And to loosen up, that needs to, I think it gets back to what you were saying earlier. You know how you're talking like that 10% flow? I think, right. I think in that sense, you know, not just veganism or environmental awareness or whatever it is, I think if we could start getting a flow happening of human beings starting to loosen up a little bit, being more real, more honest, more natural. You know, if you want to wear makeup, that's fine. It's not about hiding your face, as long as that's, you know, as long as you're doing it because you feel like it's creating a more professional presentation or it's getting a message across clearer or you're happy that way, you know?
Right.
But if you're hiding something, then it all gets weird and messed up. And then you always live a life that's small and you live a life that's always less than what you could be. And that's what I, you know.
Well, I think women, I mean, maybe this is not right, but in my opinion, like, women are judged much more on their looks than men are. Like, my husband wakes up in the morning, jumps in the shower, like, puts on a shirt, puts on a pair of pants, puts on his shoes, and walks out the door. Mm. If I did that, like, I wouldn't look presentable at, like, a business meeting, right? Because all the other women in there are going to be, they're going to have their hair in some sort of a style and they're going to have like some makeup on, not, you know, I'm not saying like a ton of makeup, but like if I went in with my hair all disheveled and like no makeup on, people would be like, that Leilani is like a bit of a slob. I'm like, I would be judged by that. Cause I've been in situations before where like, I just, a lot of times, like when I'm just walking around, if I know like obviously I knew I was going to film this Skype thing with you and I knew there was going to be video. So I brushed my hair, I put on a little bit of makeup. I wanted to look nice. But yeah, there's been lots of situations where like, if I'm just running around town and I'm like, you know, going to the grocery store or whatever, and then I've run into people that like know me from my racing or whatever. And then I'm like embarrassed. Cause like here, I'm like a total slob. My hair is a mess. I have no makeup on. I'm like totally dressed like a slob. Yeah. And I'm like, shit, like, oh, that sucks. But like they recognize me or they want to take a picture or whatever. And I look like crap. So like, but I feel like for men, like you have short hair, right? So there's only, you don't really have to do anything to style your hair. Same with my husband. He's got short hair like yours. But like for me, I've got long hair, and if I just like walk out of the house from and do nothing with it, like it is a huge mop and it would look unprofessional. And I know I would be judged on that. And I do feel like there is like, I mean, just like there is in the animal world, if you look at ecology, right, and you look at different animals, in every species, there is an animal that's like pretty, right? That there's one gender. Like in birds, it's the males. The males are the ones with the very bright, beautiful colors. Same thing with fish. It's the males that have the bright, beautiful colors, and the females are a little bit, you know, plainer and browner. But the males are the ones that are like fluffing their feathers and doing the big things with their tails and doing the dances around like to attract the females. And fish do the same thing, but they do it by like decorating an area and trying to impress the female fish to like, you know, come and look at all of this that I've made with my little home here. And with humans, it's definitely like, just look at our outfits, right? When you go to a fancy, like if you see an award show, right? It's the women that are wearing the fancy different colored dresses and all these big, you know, things to look attractive. And the men are like all in tuxedos, like they all look the same. So I do think automatically, like women, for looks wise, I do feel like women, like in our society, the way that our society is and the way that in general our species is, women are the ones in our species that is like fluffing our feathers. You know, it's the opposite. It's a reverse effect of what happens in the bird world, where it's the men that are, or the male species that's like fluffing the feathers and very bright colored, and the longer the tail, the more impressive. Like I was just in Africa recently, you know, and we were seeing the male widow bird, and they have these huge long tails, and it's so unfunctional. Like they can barely fly because their tail is so heavy. But like the longer the tail, it's something that they do in breeding season to attract the females. And it's like not functional at all. It doesn't help the bird. The bird is like struggling to even take off because the tail like weighs practically as much as the body, because it's this huge, I mean, you have the length of the bird and then the tail is like three times as long as the body. But it's to attract females. And I feel like that's the same thing like women do, right? We like high heels. It's not functional.
I felt like you were describing then, like the way you were describing that just brought to life the whole feeling of human existence. That's what we're doing. We're dragging along all this stuff to create an impression, ultimately, that we don't need it, do we? We don't actually need it. Maybe this is part of evolution. Right? All the animals, we need to put on a show. Humans are putting on a show. This is what we need to realize. We don't need that show.
Right? Like the birds are doing it because they're trying to attract a female so that they can breed, so that they can like, you know, continue on the species. I think that is like innately in people, right? Like even if we're not going to have kids and we're not going to breed, there is still that like instinctual to want to be attractive to the other sex.
Yes.
Right. That's why high heels were invented. Yes. And like, you know, all of the millions of dollars billions of dollars that is made in the fashion industry with certain cuts that make you look more attractive or like, you know, just all these little things to help us look better. All of those things are based on like trying to make us more attractive to other people.
And this is where the topic of fear kicks in again, because the more you want something, the more power fear has over your existence, right? So if you want to be attractive, you have just disabled yourself to a large degree, to varying degrees. A strong person can kind of carry that around, that discomfort, but still put on the show, but carry around the feeling of I got to put in effort to be approved of. And, you know, but if you had no fear whatsoever, that's what would be interesting. If you actually just lived in a pure place, no fear, you didn't need to be liked. You didn't need to get approval or someone to say you're a good person or a pretty woman or whatever the case may be. What would you do?
I could do that maybe when I quit racing, but like as long as I need to go out and raise millions of dollars to be able to send these messages, like I can't just decide to quit brushing my hair. You know what I mean? I can't just like be like, okay, I'm going to be a total slob and just see what happens, because it would inevitably backfire, especially in like the society that we're in.
Yeah.
Because you're selling yourself, whether you're selling, trying to get people to work with you on something. And so you're automatically going to be judged by those things. Like, I feel like that'll be a really hard one to get rid of, because everybody would have to decide to like not care about what their hair looked like or like be presentable.
Well, I think that's the movement that I think we need to start. I don't think we'd focus on, say, the makeup on the hair and, you know, ask everyone just to rip it all off straight away, you know, but maybe that, you know, like we have, you know, like no meat day and stuff. Maybe we need no makeup day where, you know what I mean? Where when women just, we need to start shifting things and getting used to being more exposed, whether it be, you know, physically, the way we look, or our personalities, our fears, our insecurities. You know, if we were more exposed, then I think we'd realize that it's not as, you know, it doesn't really matter. None of it matters, really. We think it matters in our head. I hear everything you're saying, and I get how business works and presentability, and, you know, I feel that too. Like, you know, do I, I could just put on some old clothes that I might have had on in the morning and just sit down. And, you know, I'm tempted sometimes just to take even my work to that level of whatever. Isn't what matters what I'm sharing and what I know, not you know, whether I'm presentable or whether I shave today or whatever the case may be.
Right. So,
but I, you know, the main thing I look at, say, in my journey is to make sure that it's not inhibiting me, whatever I do. You know, if I can go in there and, you know, have a shave without feeling like I'm doing it to, I don't know, get approval, then I think it's fine. If I'm doing it to get approval, then it's weakening my own resolve as a man, and then that's going to weaken my message and it's going to take me away from the truth. And that's what I'm not prepared to compromise. I'm not prepared to compromise truth. Truth is what is important, and that starts from within. And to communicate the truth of what we're observing is so much more powerful if that's been communicated from a person that's sitting in a completely honest and real space. And I think part of getting honest and real is just in the first instance is having a conversation like we're having now, where we don't say that we should do something about it, but let's first admit that we are functioning that way and make it so we get comfortable so we can all admit it. You know what I mean? Right. I think that would instantly make a difference if we could all have a little laugh with each other about what we do and how much we put on our show all the time. And because I honestly think one day it won't be necessary at all. And if women wear makeup or men wear makeup or whatever the case may be, I think we'll be doing it because for some reason that just feels like a natural expression of who we are. But if it doesn't, you know, if it's not in the truth, then it won't be that way. And I think we'll be... You know, we'll be impressed by the person, and it will really be about the energy coming out of you, not the way you look, for example. But I think that's somewhere we're not yet. So I'm not saying that we have to instantly rip the makeup off and you should just mess your hair up and get out there and say, hey, here I am, world. But at the same time, I think it's good to be aware of it and just to give yourself that break and make sure it's not holding you back as a person. And to be honest with yourself that it's not coming from an insecurity. And if it is, then address it. You know, address your insecurities in life, because otherwise, you know, you, as much as you're doing, you might be able to do more. You know what I mean? Right. More powerfully, as with me and anybody on this planet. So I just think it's essential.
It actually reminds me of this really funny Jerry Seinfeld did a stand up routine where he's talking about fashion.
Right.
And he's like, the amount of time that like humans waste on like picking out an outfit and like this color, and does that match this, and does this make my ass look big, and like he was like laughing at like how an incredible amount of like our time and our energy goes in to this stupid thing of putting clothes on. And then he gives the example of how like if you look at future movies where they're showing like the future and like we're in space, you'll see that like all of the they're all wearing the same outfit. Like if somebody at some point says, you know what, we're going to be going to other planets, we want to look like a team here, this whole individuality thing is over, from now on it's just the silver v-neck jumpsuit with the silver boots. And like how like when you see those future movies, like they're all wearing the same stuff because they're trying to look like a team because they're going to different planets. And that's what I was thinking of when you were talking about like all this effort that goes into like what we look like, and putting all this effort in is just like, you know, maybe someday we will be interplanetary and then we'll all just wear the same outfit so we look like a team.
Look, I think
we don't have to think about it anymore.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to lose our individuality. I think that if anything, maybe individual expression will rise greater, because at the moment, rather than following a trend or what other people do, maybe we'll have our own expression of beauty that will completely be coming from within. So maybe we'll all dress completely different. It'll be even more eclectic than it is today. Possibly could be the opposite to all wearing, you know, our silver boots and our V-neck shirt and stuff. Because one thing, you know, I discover is that when you free people, truly free them, you know, and I'm talking, this is a misunderstood thing on the planet yet. You know, I'm bringing up this topic knowing that in the main, it's not understood to the depth of how free we can become. People would be surprised if they go on a expansive journey, just how much you can see and feel beyond the realm of thought that we currently exist in. And it is exciting. And in that, your individuality becomes forth, you know, your uniqueness comes forth, and you do not need to be like anyone else because you're so complete in who and what you are. So there's only, you can't be anything other than what you are, other than a sharing, giving, growing entity. And in that, of course, is the uniqueness of it, because how you share your, you know, your existence is going to be different to how I share mine. But there's a purity and expression in that, and that's what becomes attractive. That's what becomes something that makes you a, you know, a wonderful person to have a conversation with, or to be able to talk about serious topics, then also have a laugh about Seinfeld, or, you know, it's that individuality that allows that. Whereas if you were sitting there this whole time feeling all completely tight and self-obsessed, then that would limit what you can share. And I think eventually we're just going to find a new way of connecting with each other where we won't need to put on a show. So what we do will be natural. Whereas at the moment, it's all very unnatural and very manufactured. And look, and businesses take advantage of that. So they feed us with all the products to keep us, you know, well masked, whether it be clothes or whatever. And then the pharmaceutical industry steps in to help us out with our neurosis from feeding into that pathway of thought of choice in the first place. So they give us a nice bunch of antidepressants and, you know, anxiety tablets to help us maintain our obsession with self. Which of course is a counterproductive, insane process we're on. So obviously we need to rip ourselves out of this insanity. Otherwise we're never going to see the truth, right? Like sometimes, you know, maybe you just need to, as a woman, do one interview one day with your hair all messy and whatever, just to experience it. You know what I mean? Just think,
see what happens.
Suddenly all your sponsors go, you got no money, like, no car, the whole thing falls apart. Probably not. You know,
she's on camera right now.
She must be crazy. What kind of woman does that? But, you know, I guess what I'm saying, we need to shake things up. And I think, you know, and we can make it fun. Like, I really think we don't have to make this a down, horrible, miserable thing we have to do. The sad part is that there is a lot of suffering going on, and we need to take that very seriously. But I think we can make this waking up journey something enjoyable, something beautiful, something rich, something freeing, you know, so we can really give each other that room to move, where we can experiment a bit more with our lives and maybe pull down the masks a bit more than we normally would, and see what life feels like, you know, and find out, how insecure am I really, you know, when I'm just walking naked, in a sense, in this world? Can I be confident? Can I hold my head up and project an energy that's still powerfully me? You know, and I think that's what we need to test, and we're not testing that. So we're too reactive to the world. And I think we need to be less reactive and just sort of dig deep and start letting out a greater truth as to our existence. And then I think a lot of these issues would be taken care of. I mean, I've often put forward, there's one solution to every problem on the planet. And that one solution is us, you know, getting over our fears and insecurities, not letting fear be the guide of our reality, because it creates a conceptual reality, which is not a truthful one. And then I think in the truth, I think we just feel so much freer and happier. And if we were happier, we would behave better, you know, and because you know that when a person's happy, they don't want to hurt anybody. They don't want to hurt an animal or a person, or they're in a more giving space because they feel they're not, because when you're happy, you're not self-obsessed in that sense. But when you're always thinking about yourself, do people like me? Am I good enough? How do you give when you're always, you know, worrying about yourself all the time? And I think if we could see that, free ourselves of it, I think we could heal the planet very quickly and do so many wonderful things. So I look forward to seeing you with your hair a mess.
No, I'm going to show up to the Adelaide Vegan Festival like a total slob. I'm not going to brush my chick. Hair. It's going to be going everywhere.
No, nice. I'm just kidding. That'd be good. Look, I've noticed we've had a wonderfully long chat, and I appreciate your time, because it's quite late where you are, isn't it? What time is it?
It's almost 10 o'clock at night.
Oh, well, that's not too bad. All right. Sorry, I thought it might have been a bit later than that. But look, I won't take up any more of your time, but that has been a wonderful conversation. I feel like we've explored so many different areas of life, and that's ultimately what Unedited Space is all about. I'm just creating a forum where we can grab people like yourself that are very powerfully doing something very important in the world, and then bring that to life in a way where it's more real and more human and more expansive, where we just talk and share and you know, it's like bringing the topics to life in a sense, so people can see it's not just about you enforcing an idea or we all need to be vegan or environmentalists. It's showing that this is just a smart human way of thinking, and that we can do it and we can make it a wonderful thing, and you certainly represent that. So thank you for today. I really do appreciate it.
That was fun. I really enjoyed our chat.
Yeah, no, it was really good. So I look forward to... So you're actually going to be at the festival, are you? You're not just on Skype or something? Yeah, great.
No, I'm coming. And the funny thing is I've been wanting to come to Australia for years and years. I've been to New Zealand, I think, 8 times now. And driving on the Great Barrier Reef has been on my bucket list since high school. I got my scuba diving license when I was in 12th grade. And which is, you know, your final year in high school in the U.S. So it's like 17 or 18. And it's always been at the top of my bucket list of scuba diving sites to see. And so I'm finally getting to do it. I hate it that it's happening, you know, after all this bleaching and a lot of the reef is struggling now. So I'm going to have to do some research on like where I should go, but we're coming down a little bit early so that we can go and do some scuba diving on the Great Barrier Reef before I come to Adelaide, for the vegan festival. So I will be there in person and I just can't wait to see the barrier reef. It's been, you know, it's just been on my wish list forever. And I think it's also, you know, that is a testament to like what you were saying about, here I live in the environmental world, right? Like I live and breathe environmental news every day. And I've known for years that we're acidifying our oceans and that our coral reefs were in danger. And yet I still took for granted that the barrier reef, you know, that I had all this time to go and see it. And even though I live and breathe the environment and I know what's happening to our oceans, you know, obviously the ocean is a carbon sink. So as we're burning fossil fuels and putting all this carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it's being absorbed by our oceans and it's acidifying the oceans and it's threatening coral reefs in addition to like, you know, the raise in temperature. And our coral reefs are so, they're so vulnerable. And I'm so mad that I finally am getting to make that trip to Australia and dive, and I'm making it just maybe like 1 year too late because a lot of the reef has bleached already just in the past year. You know, I remember I've read so many articles of scientists that, you know, marine biologists that are working there that, you know, one of them I remember said we looked at all the data, we laid it all out, and then we all cried. And one other scientist said, you know, he was crying through his mask, like as he was diving. And so, yeah, it's just, it shows that like, even though I know all this stuff, I still took for granted that it was going to be there. That's sad. 'Cause that's, you know, of all people on earth, like I'm in that group of people that like, cares about this and studies this all the time. And yet I still was like thinking, oh, you know, I still have time to go see it. And it's, I did move all of my diving bucket list sites up on my list. Like I have a bucket list and all the dive sites got moved up priority wise higher than any other of my bucket list items, because something like 2 or 3 years ago, a scientist came out and said, like, I'm so sick of environmentalists and marine biologists pretending like this is going to be okay. It's not going to be okay. And in 40 years, all of our coral reefs are going to be gone. And it was just this really, like, you were talking about being honest. He's like, screw it. I'm going to be honest. It's bullshit that we're saying that we can reverse this. We can't. We're losing them. We're losing them fast. And I remember reading that article and, like, going into my bucket list and moving all of the dive sites up. And yet, even though, like, I was aware of this, I still kind of blew it off and was like, oh, you know, maybe next year I'll go. I have to do that sometime soon. And then sure enough, right after I, you know, started planning this trip to come for the vegan festival, all of these stories started to come out about the barrier reef and how it's bleaching and really struggling. And so it's just, you know, I guess that goes into the psychology of what you're saying about, like, Even though I knew all the facts, like I still wasn't completely honest with myself. Like I have to go now or it could be never.
Yeah.
And so that's going to hit home, and I'm definitely going to, are you a scuba diver?
No.
Okay. 'Cause I was going to say, like, I need to, I need to do some research on like where I should go. And I wonder if maybe some of the days I should spend in a place that's still preserved, but maybe I should spend one day somewhere that has bleached, you know, so that I can show people like, this is what we saw in this place, but look what happened here. Because a large portion of the reef is bleached right now, from what I understand, which is just horrible. Because it's, you know, the Great Barrier Reef is the largest living structure on Earth. It's taken hundreds of millions of years for it to build. And, you know, it's amazing how just, you know, humans have done a great job of really destroying the planet.
I'm not
a huge fan of our species. Like, I like to try and be positive. Like, I think we both tried to be pretty positive and hopeful in our discussion tonight. But yeah, there are times when I just think, you know, the whole world would be better off just without us. Like, just, you know, maybe it is time for it to just go back to being the animals. We like to think of ourselves as so smart, and yet look at what we've done to our only home.
Well,
okay, so to end on that depressing note.
Yeah, that's right. I'm going to go away and cry now and crawl into bed and give up. No, look, I think it's true, but I think, you know, for you to say that is just the truth, and we need to be honest, you know? And let's be honest, but let's not give up, and I think that's the key. Even if our honesty leads us to have to face things that aren't pretty about ourselves or the planet or going to the reef and seeing the destruction and, you know, we got to use that to wake us up. We got to use that energy to propel us forward and to be more than what we have been in a big way. You know what I mean? I guess that's what I'm pushing for, is that this is not a movement where we need to go from here to here. This is a big push. We've got to rise way, way, way above where we currently sit. And that's why I think that, you know, that can come from something very straightforward, and that's just honest conversation. I really think is going to do the job. And so we don't have to make this complicated. We just got to start talking to each other and in a real way, just like you and I have been chatting tonight. You know, if everyone was talking this way, it keeps growing and it feeds new ideas and new awareness, and then we can really accelerate things. But we've just got to keep being honest and challenging the true stuff that's lying underneath the surface that we don't like talking about, and being prepared to get that out. And I think then away we go. So no, you know, to me, we can't be negative. The only way we can be negative is if we're being a victim. And as long as we're not a victim to this, I think we're going to be okay. You know, that's the key to this. Not to our own lives, not to the status of the planet. And ultimately, this is the final thing I'd like to put out there, is that if people like yourself just keep doing what you're doing, and in some ways not getting bogged down by what everyone else isn't doing, then I think this will work. Because I think there is enough of us out there putting in good hard work of education and learning ourselves as individuals to become, you know, true to what we present, so we're not fraudulent or hypocrites. I think if we don't get bogged down in what others are doing, I think this will just rise up, and it really will. And then the prediction you had earlier will come to life. But one of the keys is not to fight against the existing way and just create the new way, which ultimately is, you know, what you're representing in your industry and what you do with your work. And, you know, you're turning racing car driving into something completely different, which is wonderful, you know, to do that. So yeah, so on that note, I think it was a wonderful chat. I really appreciate it. So I once again, thank you for your time. And hopefully we'll cross paths at the Adelaide Vegan Festival.
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to it. My first trip to Oz.
Yes. All right. Sounds fantastic. All right. Well, thank you once again. And hopefully we'll be in touch in some shape or form.
Okay.
Keep this conversation alive. All right. Bye-bye.
Cheers.
See you later.
Cheers.
Bye.